But then again, the foundation of these botched raids that we're seeing all across this country, less than 50,000 a year, is the failed war on drugs that we're not properly dealing with in this country. The militarization of our police, whether it's a raid or whether it's what we're seeing now with protests, it's all because of this failed, unaddressed, faulty piece of public policy, the war on drugs.
This is CNN Breaking News.
And welcome to The Lead. I'm Jake Tapper, and we're going to start with breaking news in our national lead. Right now, there is a very heated face-off going on between protesters and police in Kentucky, where a grand jury this afternoon indicted and the state attorney general charged one police officer after the deadly police shooting of Breonna Taylor in Louisville back in March. But Taylor's family and those protesting are angry that no officers have been charged with killing Breonna Taylor. Their lawyer is calling the decision by the Kentucky Attorney General, quote, outrageous and offensive. The scene in Louisville is very tense. In the last few minutes, it has escalated with large crowds of demonstrators filling the streets and facing off against law enforcement officials, police using batons on the crowd, even appearing to push down some protesters. There's some reports of pepper balls as well. The city will go under a curfew at 9 p.m. this evening, we're told, with the National Guard on standby. The grand jury did indict former Detective Brett Hankison on three charges of wanton endangerment. That means he endangered people in other apartments when he fired 10 shots. It's an action that got him fired back in June. The other two officers who fired shots have not been charged, and the attorney general says his investigation found that their use of force was justified. CNN's Shimon Prokibas is on the ground in Louisville, Kentucky. And Shimon, a lot of disappointment among individuals who thought that there would be harsher penalties for the officers who killed Breonna Taylor, who had done nothing wrong. What's going on where you are?
Okay, so yeah, absolutely. And we're seeing that anger expressed here. We've been the crowd here has been marching for well over an hour, maybe an hour and a half here. And police this is the Highlands section of Louisville, decided to cut them off. And as we approached about a block up from here, the police they built a line and they didn't allow the protesters to walk past it. And so there was a confrontation. And as you can see, Jake, it's still continuing with many of the people in the officers' faces. And then the police moved in. They made several arrests. And as you said, I did see the officers firing those pepper balls at some of the protesters as they were trying to push them back. Some of the protesters were throwing things at the police, water bottles, other items were being thrown at the police. But for the most part, and this is important, they have been marching very peacefully. The confrontation, Jake, didn't start until the police cut off the road here. We don't know why the police chose at that time to cut off the road, but you can see here in front of me, there are people still milling about, and they're trying to figure out if the police are going to let them continue past this way. But right now, the police are not. They moved in aggressively. They pushed a lot of the protesters back, and as I said, made several arrests. But again, this didn't start until the police decided to move in and close off this area, preventing many of the protesters from continuing to march through the streets here, Jake.
And Shimon, is there anything in particular that the police might be guarding? Are they guarding a police station? Was there some indication that the marchers were going somewhere to cause any sort of violence? I mean, why would they just stop them from marching?
Yeah, that's a great question, Jake, and I don't know, because we didn't know where they were marching to. I didn't know. Our team didn't know. We just kept walking. And I could see the protesters started saying, everyone move to the front. They had seen the officers here lined up. But I don't know what it is that's ahead of us here that would cause the officers any kind of concern where they just decided, okay, it was time to stop the marchers from protesting. And it was peaceful. And you can see behind me here, there's some of the arrests that they made here. There's some of the people here on the sidewalk. They're handcuffed. There's some signs that they were carrying. Those were here on the floor. And again, as you can see, there's this officer here with this orange long gun. They were firing at the protesters As they were dispersing the crowd, as they were telling them to move back, some of the officers were firing those pepper balls. I should note that the police chief said yesterday in a press conference that he would be the one to authorize ultimately if tear gas would be used, that if any of the officers decided to use tear gas, it would be up to him or his second in command. We're being pushed back here some more. But here, as you can see, Jake, they're trying to clear more people out.
All right, Shimon.
I don't know why.
Yeah.
Shimon, why they're
doing
this. Shimon, just curfew doesn't start till 9 o'clock, Jake.
Okay, just get somewhere safe. We don't want you being shot with any pepper balls either. And continue to monitor the situation for us. Really appreciate it. As we continue to monitor and watch what's going on in the streets of Louisville, I want to bring in CNN senior legal analyst and former federal prosecutor Laura Coates and Major Neil Franklin, who worked in the Maryland State and Baltimore police departments, to talk about what we're seeing. Neil, when you're looking at these protests right now, what's the protocol here? How should law enforcement officers be handling it?
Well, first of all, listening to Shimon, I think he said that the protests were peaceful.
Yeah.
And so beginning with that, if the protests are peaceful, why are we taking any police action whatsoever? What we should be doing is assisting the protesters, right? What do you need? What do you need? So where are you going to walk? What do you need? Who's organizing the protests? Can we communicate with them? By helping the protesters and by supporting the protesters, first of all, you're doing your job because you've taken an oath to protect the rights, constitutional rights, First Amendment, freedom of speech, right? You've taken an oath to protect those rights of the protesters. So offer your assistance to the protesters so that it can remain peaceful. But when you show opposition by interfering with the peaceful protest, you're kind of asking for it.
Yeah, I mean, de-escalation seems to be something that we don't see enough of when it comes to these marches. Laura, let's talk about the decision by the grand jury and by the attorney general of Kentucky. I have to say, I find it a bit surprising that this officer has been indicted and charged with causing wanton disregard for other people by firing 10 shots into the apartment, but not for any crime related to Breonna Taylor actually being killed.
I mean, it is surprising and very hard to reconcile, isn't it, Jake? The notion that you could prosecute somebody for acting with indifference and reckless disregard for the prospective lives that could be lost, but no officer charged for the actual life that was lost in Breonna Taylor. And what we heard from the attorney general was the real litmus test here and the reason for it is because they could not conclude that that particular officer, the one that was charged with firing shots blindly and indiscriminately into a neighboring apartment that held three other occupants, that there was no indication that a bullet from his gun was actually one that was shot into Breonna Taylor. And they were not able to conclude which of the other remaining officers actually fired a fatal shot, one of six, into Breonna Taylor. But they also noted this very important thing that the AG kept harping on, and that was the notion that they believed it didn't really matter which of those two officers fired because they were justified, he believed, in using lethal force because they had first been shot upon. And so that was essentially the criteria they used to go forward. But it boggles the mind and frankly the soul to think that we're in the business of prosecuting the loss of a prospective life, but we ignore the loss of a life actually taken. And by the way, it wasn't that it was Breonna Taylor who even fired the shot.
Right.
She was somebody who was in the apartment. It was her boyfriend, Kenneth Walker, who believed that they were going to be victimized by a home invasion. And so the fact that her life was lost, it seemed as though they were implying it seemed to be collateral damage. And the idea of collateral damage not evoking a visceral reaction, talk about justice, is just, it's so hurtful to think about, but that's what it largely came down to in the disregard for what happened to her.
Neil, they say that a prosecutor can get a grand jury to indict a ham sandwich, and yet this prosecutor did not get a grand jury to indict the officer for anything having to do with the death of Breonna Taylor. Does it surprise you? Is this what you expected?
Back in the fucking car.
No, it doesn't surprise me. We see different things all across the country coming from prosecutors. And you're right. If a prosecutor really wants to get an indictment, especially for a case like this, they can do it. You know, I heard just a few seconds ago that you know, they couldn't determine who actually fired the fatal shot for Ms. Taylor. And I find that hard to believe unless the rounds were so disfigured that they couldn't get ballistics on it. And I really find that difficult to believe, especially all the guns that a typical police department, especially the size of Louisville, they've already done ballistics on the actual guns that we carry, the firearms that we, the police, carry. They do that typically before they're even assigned to you. So if you can recover the round, if it's in any, you know, any fair condition, you can get ballistics off of it. But you're right. It, you know, I just have to say something, Jake. Walking back, beginning with the raid, this was so wrong from beginning to end. And this is one of the reasons why Chief Andy Mills in Santa Cruz has put forth policy that no no-knock warrant is going to be approved in his department without his review and signature on it. You know, and that's the kind of reform that we need to see. You know, judges need to be looking at these warrants very closely. But then again, the foundation of these botched raids that we're seeing all across this country, less than 50,000 a year, is the failed war on drugs that we're not properly dealing with in this country. The militarization of our police, whether it's a raid or whether it's what we're seeing now with protests, it's all because of this failed, unaddressed, faulty piece of public policy, the war on drugs.
And Laura, the Attorney General is starting up a task force to review the process for securing and executing search warrants in Kentucky, the Attorney General of Kentucky, I should say. So it appears that he's acknowledging at least to a degree that something may have gone wrong. But based on the charges, no one is actually being held accountable for the death of Breonna Taylor.
That's correct. And the task force looks at how they can take actions prospectively, not necessarily retroactively, which, of course, does nothing for the family of Breonna Taylor or Kenneth Walker or the three occupants of the adjacent apartment. But it also notes notable that none of the three officers, I believe, who actually executed the warrant were those to actually draft or apply for the warrant. So there's already a disconnect between those who carried it out and those who applied. What they're looking for is to figure out, most notably, there's this theory going around that perhaps they already had the intended suspect who was a part of whatever drug ring they thought was a part of this case. They already had that suspect either in custody or knew about his whereabouts. And then at some later time, there's a discussion of whether the warrant at the time of execution was somehow changed or altered to reflect that they happened simultaneously. And so there's a question now about not only the drafting and application for a warrant, but whether there was anything or any shenanigans going on that would undermine the public's confidence in the way in which it was applied for, carried out, or later addressed. So all that's going to be fair game. And I would note that that's part of the issues with the civil litigation and civil settlement with the family to address how they could move forward and try to prevent these tragedies from going forward and hurting anyone else.
Neil, the ACLU reacted to today's decision saying in part, quote, today's charging decision is the manifestation of what the millions of people who have taken to the streets to protest police violence already know. Modern policing and our criminal legal system are rotten to the core, unquote. Now, you are a former police officer. What's your reaction to that? Do you agree that modern policing and law enforcement is rotten to the core?
Well, you have to understand something about the history of policing, especially when it comes to black and brown people in this country. When you look at the history of policing in this country and where it was born from, what it was born out of, which is slave patrols in the South and protection of property in the North, the model of policing in this country has never, ever been for the benefit of black and brown people in this country. We need a new model. We need a new paradigm. And this is no slight against the men and women who work hard every day. And I'm talking about those police officers who really sign up to do good work in their communities. And believe me, we have our problem eggs. What I'm talking about is a system that has never been right in this country for the benefit of not just black and brown people, but poor people as well. So we got to figure this out. And there are a number of police chiefs and sheriffs across this country that are looking forward to creating a new policing paradigm, a new model of policing in this country. And we should never, ever consider doing such a thing without the input of the community. the people that we are serving. We're supposed to be one in and of the same. So the people have to dictate what that new model of policing is going to look like and how we're going to serve them going forward.
Laura, I'm being told that actually it's an officer Cosgrove that was determined to have fired the fatal shot.
The correction to be made, and I want to clarify that the attorney general did not say that he was not aware of which of the officers were firing on Breonna Taylor. The question was, because only one of the shots was actually fatal, one of the six contributed immediately to their death, they said they weren't able to determine which of those particular, as opposed to the other officer. But in and of itself, it was irrelevant to the overall inquiry, which is the most disturbing aspect of it. And that is the idea that because they found the officers justified in using lethal force, ultimately did not matter to them, legally speaking, who delivered the fatal shot, because they were justified in the use of force anyway. And so that's why it did not lead to a prosecution, they say. But you're right, they are able to determine which particular bullet, but in the idea of whether it was relevant legally to a prosecution, it was not.
And Neil, I want to...
Jake, can I say something real quick?
Well, I want to push back on something, or not push back, or just ask you about something and then go on and make your point. But that is, I heard an interview with Congresswoman mm-hmm. Val Demings of Florida, former police chief, I believe from Orlando, or at least the surrounding area. And she said that she does not support defunding the police because the minority communities are the ones who depend upon police more than any other community, and that diverting funds from police would end up hurting minority communities, black and brown people. This is obviously a black woman, a former police officer, a member of Congress, member of Congress, saying that. How does that square with what you said?
So it's not just that simple. We're not just talking about taking money away from the police and doing nothing with it, is what defunding the police sounds like. What we're talking about is divesting to invest, divestment, investing in those things, those services, those needed services within our neighborhoods and communities, mental health, nutrition, education, housing, dealing with our houseless population, the homeless population, and all those things that contribute to crime. If we want to solve crime long-term, improving public safety for the long-term in this country, we've got to start shifting resources from public safety, from corrections, from policing, to those things within our community that mm-hmm. I just talked about that work for improving the economic conditions, improving the health, the environmental health, and so on within those communities. That's what we're talking about here.
So Major Neil Franklin and Laura Coates, stick around. I'm going to come right back to you, and we're going to continue to cover what's going on in Louisville. But I want to also note that coming up from the wife of the Republican presidential nominee,